فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
Chapter: To love the Ansar is a sign of faith. Narrated by Anas radiallahu anhu, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, to love the Ansar is a sign of faith, and to hate the Ansar is a sign of hypocrisy.
حدثنا أبو الوليد.
أبو الوليد هي is هشام بن عبد الملك الطيالسي. نعم.
قال حدثنا الشعبة.
شعبة is ابن الحجاج أبو بسطام العتكي أمير المؤمنين في الحديث. And he is from من أوائل من فتشوا عن الحديث بالعراق. We mentioned that he's the first person who put down in the science جرح التعديل. نعم.
قال أخبرني عبد الله بن عبد الله بن جبر. قال سمعت أنسا رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال آية الإيمان حب الأنصار وآية النفاق بغض الأنصار.
آية means علامة, sign. آية means علامة, sign of loving the Ansar is, who are Ansar? Ansar are the people of Medina. They used to be known as Qayla. They used to be known as what? Qayla. And their two main tribes, Aus and Khazraj. Aus and Khazraj, they used to be known as Qayla, and they got known as Ansar. Why were they then known as Ansar? لأنهم, because the reason why they got given that name is because لأنهم نصروا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. They gave victory to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. They aided his da'wah. They supported his da'wah. So they gained that title, and they fought with him عليه الصلاة والسلام. They put their lives on the line for him عليه الصلاة والسلام رضي الله تعالى عنهم. Even their children are known as Ansar. Are you there? Their children are known as Ansar. Not only that, their slaves are also known as Ansar. So Ansar is not only Aus and Khazraj alone. Even that though, they're the majority. This hadith tells us, Hubbul Ansari, loving Ansar, it is a sign of a person's iman. And a sign of a person's hypocrisy is بغض الأنصار, hating the people of Ansar. And Allah تبارك وتعالى, He gave these individuals a status. Why would you hate them for? ولذلك Allah says in the Quran, محمد رسول الله والذين معه أشداء على الكفار رحماء بينهم تراهم ركعا سجدا يبتغون فضلا من الله ورضوانا سيماهم في وجوههم من أثر السجود ذلك مثل في التوراة ومثل في الإنجيل كزرع أخرج شطأه فآزره فاستغلظ فاستوى على سوقه يعجب الزراع ليغيظ بهم الكفار. The Sahabas were made to what? ليغيظ بهم الكفار. The reason why the companions, Allah made them around the Prophet, is so the disbelievers can hate them. So when you hate the Sahabas, you're falling under being from the, a person who's from the disbelievers. So it's very, very dangerous. The only people who are hating them are the people who are what? The disbelievers. So loving the Ansar is an iman. And another thing that's taken from this hadith as a benefit is that the virtue of loving the people who call to Allah's path and who call to salvation. Because the reason Ansar are loved for is because they gave victory to this religion. And the du'at, the people who are calling to the path of Allah, the du'at who are calling the people to the deen of Allah, they should be loved. If they're calling to the path of Allah, they're calling it correctly, then love should be shown to them. As we now see that we love Ansar, not as the same love, because the level of Ansar's victory for Islam is higher than the love of a da'i today. But a person who's calling to the religion of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he should be loved just like this hadith proves. Naam.
Chapter. Sorry, within the same chapter. Narrated by Ubadah ibn Samit radiallahu anhu, who took part in the Battle of Badr and was a naqib. On the night of Al-Aqaba, the pledge, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, while a group of his companions were around him, give me the bay'ah, the pledge for Number one, not to join anything in worship with Allah. Number two, not to steal. Number three, not to commit illegal sexual intercourse. Number four, not to kill your children. Number five, not to utter slander, intentionally forging falsehood. Number six, not to be disobedient, to do ma'roof, Islamic monotheism, and all other good deeds. And the Prophet added, whoever amongst you fulfills his pledge will be rewarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And whoever indulges in any one of these sins gets the punishment in this world, that punishment will be an expiation for that sin. And if one indulges in any of them and Allah conceals his sin, it is up to Allah to forgive or punish him in the hereafter. Ubaidah ibn Samit radiallahu anhu added, so we gave the bay'ah for these.
باب حدثنا أبو اليمان قال أخبرنا شعيب عن الزهري قال
محمد بن الشهاب الزهري زهري محمد بن الشهاب الزهري نعم
قال أخبرني أبو إدريس أبو إدريس عائذ الله بن عبد الله أن عبادة بن صامت رضي الله عنه
عبادة بن صامت هو من كبار الصحابة he's from the noble companions of the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم and عبادة بن صامت he combined between two virtues جَمَعَ بَيْنَ مَنْقَبَتَيْنِ He combined between two virtues that are very high in Islam. The first one is شَهِدَ بَدْرًا He participated in the battle of Badr. And Allah تبارك وتعالى, what did he say? Or what did the Prophet ﷺ say about the people of Badr? What did the Prophet say? To Umar ibn Khattab, he said, وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ يَا عُمَرْ لَعَلَّ اللَّهَ اِطَّلَعَ عَلَى أَهْلِ بَدْرٍ فَقَالَ اعْمَلُوا مَا شِئْتُمْ فَإِنِّي قَدْ غَفَرْتُ لَكُمْ Oh, the people of Badr, do as you wish, Allah has forgiven you for your sins. Do what you want. Allah has forgiven you for your sins. That's the virtue that the people of Badr have received. And the virtue that they've gained. The second thing that he benefited from was, he was from the Nuqaba. He was from the Nuqaba of Ansar, the elite chosen individuals. Laylat al-Aqabati, the night of Aqaba, when the Bay'ah, the pledge of allegiance was being given to the Prophet. And Allah praised those people in the Quran when he say, لا يستوي منكم من أنفق من قبل الفتح وقاتل أولئك أعظم درجة من الذين أنفقوا من بعد وقاتلوا So he's before the Fath Makkah. The Nuqaba are before Fath Makkah. They're before Fath Makkah. And he falls under that. So he's got those two virtues. عبادة بن صامت رضي الله تعالى عنه. نعم.
قال وهو أحد النقباء ليلة العقبة أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال وحوله عصابة من
وحوله عصابة means جماعة عصابة is from it's a number from 10 to 40 any number between 10 to 40 you can call that an عصابة a group of people who come together from the numbers of 10 to 40 is a عصابة نعم
وحوله عصابة من أصحابه بايعوني على ألا تشركوا بالله شيئا.
بايعوني means عاهدوني. Take a covenant with me. Take a covenant with me. And the Arabs they use the word بايعة. Are you with me? Because every single body who's giving the pledge of allegiance has to stick out their hands, their باع to give the pledge of allegiance like that. That's why in Arabs they call it بايعة. Except that the women for them is مجاز. Even though the بايعة has been said for them, the Prophet ﷺ never used to shake the hands of the women. صح? When the woman tried to stick her hand out for the Prophet to do bay'ah with him, he said, إِنِّي لَا أُصَافِحُ النِّسَى The Prophet said to her, I don't shake women's hands. Are you with me? خَيْرُ قَلْقِ اللَّهِ The best of creation. The most righteous, the most humble, the most clean-hearted individual you could ever find. مَعَذَلِكَ He's telling the woman, I don't shake women's hand. And you're like, no, I'm pious, no problem, inshallah, hey, sister. Don't worry, inshallah, my iman is strong, I'm not worried for myself. Tell them, I don't shake women's hands, khalas. The Prophet is telling this woman, he knows that she won't be upset with it. And even if she does become upset with it, that we can't do what is known as what? لا طاعة لمخلوق في معصية الخالق. We obey and give obedience to the creation of that over the creator. We don't do that. We say, excuse me, our religion doesn't allow us to shake women's hands. Okay? It doesn't. So we need to know to hold on to our Islamic ethics. Okay? We have a religion. We have to follow protocols, we follow them. And we tell the people around us in a very wise, well-mannered manner. But we don't lie about it, and we don't tamper with our religion and change it when it suits us. So the Prophet ﷺ said to them, Bayi'uni, give me a pledge of allegiance. Okay, on what?
Allah.
Now I want you to all ponder on what the Prophet took pledge of allegiance with his companions on. Pay attention and focus. It's very important that you look at this. What was the bay'ah upon? Okay, hey.
أَلَّا تُشْرِكُوا بِاللَّهِ شَيْئًا.
That you don't associate partners with Allah, شَيْئًا. أَلَّا تُشْرِكُوا is نَفْيٌ فِي سِيَاقِ نَكِرَةٌ فِي سِيَاقِ النَّفْيُ تُفِيدُ العموم, generalization, شَيْئًا whatsoever. You don't associate partners with Allah whatsoever. It can be a jinn, it can be a hajar, it can be a shajara, it can be a malak, it can be a shams, qamar, kawkabun, shaytanun, whatever it is. You cannot worship anything besides Allah. It can be a nabiyun mursal, or malakun muqarrab. Doesn't matter. Shay'an. Generalization. The first thing that the Prophet took pledge of allegiance with them with what? Tawheed. There's nothing before that, brothers. Tawheed. A people who don't know Tawheed, there's not la khayra fihim. Man dayya haqq Allahi, falima siwahu adya. Anyone who forsakes the rights of Allah, then he's going to forsake every other right that comes after it. Sah? A person who has no understanding of Allah's Tawheed and Allah's oneness and how ibadatullahi wahadahu and what ibadah means and doesn't have any understanding of it. Don't tell him, wala taqtulu awladakum amma, wala tasriqu, wala taznu. The Prophet didn't fall to all of that. Tawheed. And this is, it keeps coming back, and it will come back a lot in the nusus. You have to realize now, the Prophet in Mecca, he's what? Brothers, where are we living today? Where do we live? We live in the UK today. Are we weak in the UK? Are we minority in the weak in the UK? Yes, we are a minority in this country. Was the Prophet ﷺ a minority in Mecca? Are we different from his situation? Rather, his situation was more tougher than ours, right? Alayhi kadhalik? His situation was better than ours. Sorry, our situation is better than his. Sahih? At that point, the Prophet ﷺ didn't say, listen, we need to do elections. We need to be engaged in the politics of the country. We need to know what's happening, what they're doing in their assemblies. We need to watch their... Did the Prophet do any of that? Brothers, this is important. Focus here. He's got 40 up to... It can be from the number 10 to 40. Companions who are hands open. He's now going to talk to them. Look at the nuqad, the points he agrees with them, alayhi salatu wa sallam. If you're trying to take the Muslims out of the UK and you want, mashallah, to bring prosperity and success and unite the Muslims together, unite them on these points. Don't waste the Muslims' time on something that they're not going to benefit anything from it. And they're going to get tired. And they're going to lose out. Are you there? I got a wound on me. And all you do is you get Vaseline and you put Vaseline on my skin. And am I infa'uni? Are you there, brothers? That won't benefit me. I got a wound. I need surgery. Blood is gushing out of my body, methylene. The ummah are wounded like that. So the solution where it lies, if you take them away from it, you're deceiving the ummah. And you're causing them more harm than what they're in. Because they're trusting you. So it's very dangerous. These points are very important. Look what the Prophet says. We're going to stand over each one. First thing is what? Shirk. Stay away from shirk. Worship Allah alone. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam leaves that so strongly. In the Arabic language, look how powerful this is. وَعَلَىٰ أَلَّا تُشْرِكُوا بِاللَّهِ شَيْئًا. Don't associate partners with Allah. You hear a person who's a da'i calling to Allah. Wallahi, you don't hear one time calling the people to Tawheed. Not once. Are you there? He's a da'i, he's called the da'i illallah, min du'ati illallah, you know, from the da'i. La, one time he doesn't tell the people, ibadatullahi wahda. وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِاللَّهِ شَيْئًا. He doesn't say that to them. What's the job of the da'i? قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُوا إِلَىٰ مَنْ. Who do we call the people to? قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُوا إِلَىٰ اللَّهِ. I call the people to Allah. Not my organization, not my group, not my titles, not my name. قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُوا إِلَىٰ اللَّهِ عَلَىٰ بَصِيرَةٍ أَنَا وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِي وَسُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ وَمَا أَنَا مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. This is the path of every person who comes after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The path which he calls the people to is Allah. Ibadatullahi wahda. Muslims, let's focus back to Allah. Let's make the focus point Allah. When we sit in conversations, politics ain't going to take us out of anything. Let's focus on Allah. Our reason we're suffering and we're going through hardship is because our relationship with Allah is cut. And when Allah, that rope got cut, Allah has said to us, you solve your situations. And anyone who Allah Ta'ala leaves them the way they are, they're not going to make their heads up. And they're not going to be successful. So let's just try to rebuild the relationship with Allah. Connect ourselves back to Allah. Give our affairs to Him. Follow His command as He writ it. Stage one, stage two, follow this one. Okay, follow this, next one, step by step. With those who are people of knowledge, let's stand behind them. Listen to what they tell us about, what they extract for us. That's what brings salvation, Allah. That's exactly what salvation is. Now.
وَلَا تَسْرِقُوا.
So well, the first one is وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا صح? After وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِاللَّهِ شَيْئًا.
وَلَا تَسْرِقُوا.
وَلَا تَسْرِقُوا. Don't steal. وَلَا تَسْرِقُوا. Don't steal. Don't rob anything. Hey, وَلَا.
وَلَا تَزْنُوا.
Don't commit zina.
وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ.
Don't kill your children.
وَلَا تَأْتُوا بِبُهْتَانٍ تَفْتَرُونَهُ بَيْنَ أَيْدِيكُمْ وَأَرْجُلِكُمْ.
Don't come with lies, forged statements.
وَلَا تَعْصُوا فِي مَعْرُوفٍ.
وَلِذَلِكَ وَاللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى وَدِي سَيْ وَلَوْلَا إِذْ سَمِعْتُمُوهُمْ. If you hear them, قُلْتُمْ مَا يَكُونُ لَنَا أَن نَتَكَلَّمَ بِهَذَا سُبْحَانَكَ هَذَا بُهْتَانٌ عَظِيمٌ. Making up forged statements against the Muslims. Making up information that the Muslims haven't done. ولذلك the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم when he came to his companions, he said, أَتَدْرُونَ مَا الْغِيبَةِ. Do you know what backbiting is? The Sahabas, they said, Allah wa Rasulu A'lam, Allah and His Messenger know. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, ذِكْرُكَ أَقَاكَ بِمَا يَكْرَهُ. It's to say about your brother what he dislikes. So the Sahabas, they said, قِيلَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, O Messenger of Allah, أَفَرَأَيْتَ إِن كَانَ فِي أَخِي مَا أَقُولُ. What about if what I'm saying about my brother is in him? And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, إِن كَانَ فِيهِ مَا تَقُولُ فَقَدْ اخْتَبْتَ. If what you're saying about your brother is in him, then you backbited him. And if what you're saying about wa illam yakun, and if it's not in him, فِيمَا تَقُولُ, that which you say about him, فَقَدْ بَهَتَ, you've lied about him. So even what you're saying about him, if it's in him, like some people tell you, Allah, I'm only saying the truth. Wallahi, I'm only saying the truth. That brother, the short brother, who ugly brother, Wallahi, I'm saying the truth. Hey, yeah, that's how he looks. That's how he is. He with me. That's ghiba. ذِكْرُكَ أَخَاكَ بِمَا يَكْرَهُ. If you lie about him, then it becomes even worse. Na'am. So the buhtan, it means making up something that's not true. What saying about what the person is lacking is what? Is ghibah, it's backbiting. Even if the person has those things, it's backbiting based on what the Prophet ﷺ said. And Imam al-Nawawi brings out six situations when it's different. Like in, he's got a bab in Kitab al-Riyadh al-Salihin where he called it babu. مَا يُبَاحُ مِنَ الْغِيبَةِ. بَابُ مَا يُبَاحُ مِنَ الْغِيبَةِ. When a woman wants to complain about her husband because he's being hard to her, he's not providing for her, for instance, and she goes to the judge and she says, look, this is my husband, he is stingy, she's backbiting him. She's saying about him what he is, صح? But it's permissible for her, just like Hinda bint Utba, she said about Abu Sufyan, she said, رَجُلٌ شَحِيحٌ, he's a stingy man, صح? رضي الله تعالى عنه. Also, if a sister comes up to you and says to you, sister, I want to get married, brother, I want to get married, I'm looking for a wife. A sister comes up to you and says to you, brother, brothers have come for my hand in marriage, and so and so has come in my hand. Do you know of them? And what do you think of them? You can say, I don't think you should marry any of them. All of those guys you mentioned, لا خير فيهم, none of them have good, leave them alone. Marry Fulan. You're allowed to say that. Based on the hadith of Fatima bint Qais. The hadith of what? Fatima bint Qais, when the Prophet, she came to the Prophet, she said, Ya Rasulallah, O Messenger of Allah, Abu Jahm and Muawiyah have both come for my hand in marriage. The Prophet said, Abu Jahm, ha, darrabul lin nisa, he beats the women up. Another narration says, La yulqil asa al atiqi. The stick is always on his shoulder, he's always got it ready. He beats the women, don't marry him. As for Muawiyah, fasu'lukul la mala lahu, he has no money, nothing to provide you with. Don't marry him. Hey, who shall marry? Marry Usama ibn Zayd. He's the right one for you. Are you with me? So if a person asks you for your idea on a marriage issue, you can't deceive the sister, say, oh Allah, I can't tell you. Allahu alam, I don't want to backbite. You don't say that. You tell her what you know, and you stick to what's needed. Don't go extra unnecessary things. Just like the sister wants to complain about her husband in the qadi, she shouldn't go off board. Yeah, even when he's driving, he goes through red lights and unnecessary things, it falls under the ghibah that's prohibited. And then the issue is that she has to stick with the problem that she has with him. Are you with me? And also the issue of if a person is asking, warning about a person who's causing harm to the people's religion, is also falls under babu ma yubahu min al-ghiba. So and so, just like a sister's marriage issue, you tell her not to marry this brother, the ummah, you tell them this person is calling your children to deviated ideologies. Stay away from them. Don't take your children to this place. Your kids are becoming deviated, it's permissible. But it becomes permissible, ikhwani, with what? With shurut, conditions. These things have just been made unrestrictedly, so the person just dwells in the people's honors. Be careful. Hiya.
وَلَا تَعْصُوا فِي مَعْرُوفٍ فَمَنْ وَفَى مِنْكُمْ فَأَجْرُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ
وَلَا تَعْصُوا فِي مَعْرُوفٍ.
No.
Is that the person who has rights over you, the leader that has rights over you, the parents that have right on you. Are you with me? Then obey them. Are you with me? Give them the right of obedience in that which is good. But if they tell you to do things that go against Allah's command, don't obey them in it. They have no. فَمَنْ وَفَى, anybody who fulfills this, فَأَجْرُ عَلَى اللَّهِ, his reward is in it. His reward is with who? Anyone who comes with all of those that have been mentioned, his reward is with who? Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. فَمَنْ أَصَابَ مِنْ ذَلِكَ شَيْئًا, anybody who comes with any of those which was mentioned, who falls in any of those. So a person falls short on any of those. ثُمَّ سَتَرَهُ اللَّهِ, and then Allah conceals it for him. فَوَ إِلَى اللَّهِ إِنْ شَاعَفَ عَنْهُ وَإِنْ شَاعَقَبَهُ. This hadith is a refutation on the murji'ah and it's a refutation on the khawarij. Other than tawheed, if the person the Prophet is saying, if somebody falls short by stealing, or he falls short by committing zina, or he falls short by killing his children, مثلاً, or he makes up forged statements against the Muslims, or you know he doesn't listen to his parents and doesn't obey it. فَمَنْ وَفَى مِنْكُمْ فَأَجْرُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ. This hadith mentions that this person now falls under Allah's mashi'ah. ما معنى Allah's mashi'ah? Allah does what He wishes with this person. If He wants, He takes that person and He places him in the hellfire. Or if He wants, Allah conceals it for him like He concealed it for him in the earth, and He will tell him, I forgave you, go to Jannah. Are you there? What did the Khawarij say? If you do any of these sins, you're in there? Forever. When I say the Khawarij, also the Mu'tazila are the same. They believe that Murtakib al-Kabira, the one who does the major sin, what do they believe? He's in the hellfire forever. This hadith shows that he might even enter Jannah without even going to the hellfire. Sah? Also, this hadith shows that, as the murji'ah say, that if you come with qawlul qalb and qawlul lisan, you utter la ilaha illallah on your tongue, you have al-iqrar in your heart, affirmation in your heart, that's enough. That will take you to Jannah, 100%. This hadith shows that these people are entering Jannah, these people are entering the hellfire for what reason? They committed zina, that's why they're going to the hellfire. So it shows that they are falling into wajibat that left. Actions that they came short on. Are you listening to me, brothers? So it's a refutation on the who? The murji'ah. Murji'ah believe that if you come with qawlul qalb and qawlul lisan, your iman is kamil and you enter Jannah. But now we're seeing a people who's, based on their opinion, who has complete iman, but he's going to the hellfire. They're wrong on this. And this issue, this hadith is used for the concept of the murtakib al-kabira, the one who does major sin. Now some may say, oh really? So I might enter Jannah straight away. Why would you place yourself on a situation where you don't know if you're going to go Jannah or not? Why would you even do that? Are you with me, brothers? A believer will never, he will stay away from this. You can see a path where you can just enter Jannah. Why would you wait for that day for Allah to say either Jannah or Nar? Are you with me, brothers? And these acts are very serious. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala protect us from killing anyone. Or may Allah protect us subhanahu wa ta'ala from lying against an individual. Or committing zina. Or stealing. Or disobeying our parents and those who have authority over us. Now.
Chapter, the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Chapter, to flee from al-fitn is a part of religion. Narrated by Abi Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu anhu, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, A time will come when the best property of a Muslim will be sheep, which he will take on the top of mountains and the places of rainfall, so as to flee with his religion from al-fitan.
باب من الدين الفرار من الفتن. حدثنا عبد الله بن مسلم.
الإمام البخاري here brings رحمه الله تعالى from the branches of الإيمان. من شعب الإيمان. This is all the branches of إيمان. Is what? الفرار من الفتن. Run away from trials and tribulations. Run away from trials and tribulations. Run. Don't go to it. Run away from trials and tribulations. Fitna. Whether it be fitna shubuhat or fitna shahwat.